construction in Toronto. So anyway, Jerry helped him put his patio door. But where the patio is, the front of the house, there's no siding. So Jerry's going to help him put the siding up and stuff. Yeah, Gary's gonna put a sign. So hopefully, Dan Mantle will help him because Gary Jacks are straight too. Like, he was leaning, that was a lot of work.
Did he get the foundation underneath?
Not the whole foundation. He took patio stones and cement blocks.
Okay.
No, the shed roof to do that would be possible. He wouldn't do that now. You know? So he put it on patio stone, so he put a lot around it. But it was sort of tipping off the wall. So he did. One row is really good. The side is all done. He just has to put it back in.
Jesus and the dawn of new light on Easter Day in which we live each day, we light now this candle. Please be seated. Let us bow. As we declare our praise to you, O God, we remember the multitude of blessings that you have given to us. We are mindful of the ways in which you have lifted us when we have fallen low. Be with us this day as we gather to hear your word for our lives, and help us to listen closely. Remind us that you are always with us. Give us confidence in your presence so that we might go into the world ready to witness to your love through our works and deeds. For we ask these things in the name of Christ. Amen. Now we unite hearts and minds and souls as we hear the prayer that Jesus taught us. Time since March. Welcome also those who have gathered here electronically. Now we all have our feelings and thoughts about worship and about gathering in this place. And some may be excited, very happy to see others. And some may also be quite anxious about it and concerned. But whatever we feel or whatever we think, we are welcome in the presence of God. Things are not and will not be the way they were way back in March, at least not for a while anyway. And in the meantime, we are doing what we can. We're placing our focus there rather than on what we can't do. We're focusing in a positive way, doing what we can, grateful for each other and for some sort of gathering for worship. So please follow instructions as you see them or hear them. They're not there to impede our freedom, but they're there to allow us to keep each other as safe as possible, to allow us to meet in some sort of physical way. I know sometimes there is that impulse we have, you know, to fight back when we're told that we should do something. Please, if you're feeling that, that's okay to feel it. But please choose to do something different. Choose instead to reframe it in your hearts and in your minds, understanding and helping other people by paying attention to those rules. And after the service, when we finish, you can go outside if you want to talk. There's no reason we can't talk to each other. You can go outside in the yard, masked and socially distant, and still see each other and chat. But please remember, you can do that. There's nothing wrong with that. Just take appropriate actions, making sure you're distant and caring for other people with what you do. If you'd like to help with some aspect of the service, please let me or Debbie, when she's in the office, know about it. We do need volunteers. We need people to act as cantors, name-taking at the door, or cleaning issues, and other things that happen when we gather in a physical way like we do today. So if you're willing to do something, let us know, and we're very happy to have volunteers. Today, Barbara Fowler is acting as our cantor. She is singing hymns in the service on all our behalf. You know that we are not able to sing when we gather, but we are allowed to have soloists and people who sing on our behalf in this way. We thank her and Judy for their leadership of music during the service. Please make sure you follow social distancing rules and you disinfect hands and all that sort of stuff. Remember that the sanctuary remains from Wednesday till Sunday a forbidden zone. No one is to be in here. And if you see that on the sign, yes, it's for you. It's not only for you, it's for me, it's for Judy, it's for everybody. Please remember that that allows things to rest the 5 days to make sure that the virus isn't present in that sanctuary. For office hours, if you need to see me, they're being held in my home still. I have an office there. And you can contact me at any time. The phone numbers are on the church answering machine, and I'd be glad to hear from you. Those are the announcements that I have. I know that on October the 6th, the worship committee is going to be meeting via Zoom, and you will get an invitation to that this week. But are there any other announcements that need to be made this time? No one is waving furiously. Whatever our struggles, whatever our miracles, whatever our burdens, whatever our fruitful labor, we are thankful for our blessings from God, God's good creation. As a sign of that gratitude, let us now offer our offerings and our gifts. Beloved, we are grateful for your many gifts to us, your many blessings day by day. As a sign of our gratitude, we bring these gifts for your use, signs of our lives and our livelihood. Bless these gifts for your work in the world. We present these gifts in the name of Christ. Amen. Now, some of you, you've all got masks on, so I can't tell, you know, but some of you, you gentlemen, do you have mustaches underneath your, I see John has one. Others, anyone else with a mustache? Anyone ever had a mustache? Oh, I see. You've got, did it take you a long time to grow your mustache, John?
About a month
or so. I decided to bypass all of that. I'm just getting my own right here. And that's what you need, John.
Gotcha.
It's instant. It just happens. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to groom it. You don't ever have to trim it. It just stays exactly as you've ever seen a mustache before. And it works relatively well. I'm surprised it's actually staying on. But, you know, some of you might say that's not fair. You didn't go to all the trouble of growing your own mustache. You didn't go to the trouble of trimming and shaping that wonderful Dali-like experience on your face. You just peel the stick thing off the back and put it on. Well, that's true. I guess that's true. And there are a lot of things in our lives that we say, well, that isn't fair. That isn't, you know, you didn't work very hard for that. How did that happen? How did you end up, with whatever it is? And we can be concerned sometimes about issues of fairness. Is that fair? Is that fair that such and such has happened? Is that fair that someone has something I don't have? It's fair that someone didn't put all the effort into something that we did. And we can even think that God needs to be fair with us, and we also need to be grateful that God isn't fair. God gives us a lot more than we deserve. And that's the story and message of grace, that we get more than we deserve with God, and that things aren't fair, and that God has his finger on the balance of our lives, tipping things, but for our benefit, not for our detriment. And it's hard sometimes for us to be grateful for others and the good things that come into their lives that seemingly drop from nowhere. But we're invited to look at others in the same way, with grace, and be grateful for the things that they receive as well, whether they've worked hard for us or not, in our estimation, or whether it's fair or equal or not, and the whole thing in that regard. We're going to hear a little bit about that in a story that Jesus told a long time ago. But I'll leave you that thought to think about as you hear the gospel readings. Before that, we're going to hear the words of a hymn. It's entitled Fairest Lord Jesus, light your hearts and souls and minds to receive the gift that I bring to you today.
Thank you.
The Old Testament passage comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 16, verses 2 to 15. We read, "The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, 'If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out here into the wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger.' And the Lord said to Moses, 'I'm going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on the other days.' So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, 'In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. But what are we that you complain against us?' And Moses said, 'When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening, fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard your complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord.' Then Moses said to Aaron, 'Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining.' And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked towards the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, 'I heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God.' In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp. And in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, 'It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat.' This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." The gospel reading comes from Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 to 16. Jesus is teaching. "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When those hired at about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now, when the first came, they thought they would receive more. But each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to go and choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the first will be last, the last will be first.' This is the gospel of Christ. Thanks be to God." For some of you who don't know, I have 2 children. They are about 15 months apart in age, and they're now both in their mid-20s. Caitlin is the older, Brendan the younger. And I think it was Caitlin's 4th birthday, and she was given a gift. Actually, she was given more than one. And her little brother, almost three, didn't quite understand the idea of celebrating someone else's birthday. He grew visibly irritated, and crossed his little arms, and with emotion spilling over and out of his little mouth, he said, "It no fair, it no fair." And there was no dissuading a three-year-old with designs for gifts too. And inside every three-year-old, there is a lawyer concerned with fairness and justice issues. It no fair. And the truth is, everyone over the age of three has a three-year-old child inside that cries out, "It's not fair." Sometimes. It's not fair. But what is fairness? I mean, sometimes we mean saints. Where there is fairness, everything is equal. Everyone, therefore, pays the same price for a movie theater ticket. No one has more than another. Everyone eats or no one does. Fairness is finding the average and applying it across the board. This is fairness as equality of outcome. But sometimes fairness is about getting what you deserve. If you work hard and you succeed, you get to keep what you have earned. So the hardest working, the most diligent, the smart, and the talented should probably have more because of these qualities that they have. Those who are lazy or uncaring or inept deserve to have less. And fairness is rational. It's calculated. This is fairness as individual freedom, as a choice, as a responsibility. But also fairness could be about those who have more to give and how they should do so. They can have a greater percentage to help others and give that, to help out those who are unable to contribute. Fairness encompasses the notion that people have an obligation to one another. And the more that one has, more is demanded to contribute to the common good. Fairness is linked to responsibility. Compassion has a role. This is fairness as social justice. It's not fair. It no fair. A three-year-old near us, or perhaps parents, cries out sometimes. If I said to you, "It's not fair that," you could probably fill in the blank and finish the sentence, because if there's one thing that we all have got, it's an innate sense of fairness. It's a powerful and wonderful thing, because that same sense of fairness, when it develops into maturity, is the foundation for justice and equality. It's not fair that some can vote and others can't, that some ride in the front of the bus and others have to stay in the back, that some have lives that matter and some apparently don't, that some get paid more for the same work and others don't receive the same wage when they work. It's not fair that some go to bed hungry, while others fill their garbage cans with excess. Yes, our innate sense of fairness can lead to a stronger and life-giving sense of justice and ethics. And fairness can speak to all the problems that we have, problems like racism and sexism and poverty. But not always. Innate sense of fairness tends to be egocentric. We tend to assess fairness as examples from our childhood would demonstrate in terms of what seems fair, not only to us, but also for us. We tend to measure fairness, that is, in terms of our own needs and wants and hopes and expectations, often with little or maybe secondary regard for the wants and needs that others have. But unfortunately, this doesn't always end with childhood, which brings us to Jesus' parable about day laborers. be a day laborer. These are the people with no regular employment, and so they have to stand in the town square hoping that some landowner or manager needs some extra work done and will hire them. The trouble is, though, there was usually a lot more laborers than there was labor. And there's no EI or CERB or social services to fall back on. So if you were both healthy and lucky, you'd get chosen and work a 12-hour day. And when you were done, you would receive a day's wages that would provide food for your family for the next day. We heard earlier the words of the Lord's Prayer Jesus taught, saying to, you know, give us this day our daily bread. Well, a day's wage bought your daily bread. If you are lucky or unhealthy, you'd get passed over, possibly waiting all day to return empty-handed to face the disappointed looks of those who depended on you. But in the parable that Jesus tells, everybody gets lucky. Some are chosen early, some more late morning, or at noon, or mid-afternoon, or some just an hour before quitting time. And no doubt these last were probably not just pleasantly surprised, but downright flabbergasted by their good fortune when they received a full day's wage for an hour of work. Not because they hadn't wanted to work all day. After all, they'd been there just the same as all the others, ready, willing, and eager, but they'd been passed over time and again until right near the end. And so I suspect they were delighted to discover that they'd be able to provide at least for another day for their family. And this act of generosity sets up expectations. Those who had worked all day started doing their mental calculations, adding up, anticipating just how much more they would receive than they had originally expected or been contracted for. And it's hard to blame them. I mean, after all, if folks who worked just 1 hour got a full day's wage, wouldn't it only be fair give the folks who work 12 long hours a little bit more, or maybe a lot more? But that's not what happens. They receive a full day's wage, nothing more, nothing less, just as they were promised. And they're disappointed, maybe even angry. It just doesn't seem it no fair. But the landowner reminds them that in fact it's totally fair. They are being paid just what was promised. If anything, the landowner is being more than fair, actually downright generous to those who were invited late in the day, as well as perfectly fair to those who were fortunate to be called to work early. Why then begrudge such generosity? Why does generosity bring out our sense of entitlement? The landowner says literally, is your eye evil because I'm good? Sometimes it gets translated, are you envious because I'm generous? But it's all about seeing, it's about perspective, losing perspective. That's wrapped up in envy. Indeed, except perhaps that it's human nature. I mean, there are a lot of ways to read the story of the fall in Genesis. Of course, it's primarily a story about our own insecurity and lack of trust and how we come to understand and assess our lives, not through the abundance that we've been given by God, but instead by what we feel we lack. Because of this gnawing sense of lack, we define ourselves over and against other people, comparing and begrudging their good fortune because it wasn't our good fortune. How are we going to look at our lives? How are we going to look at others? What's our perspective? Well, think for a moment of what this does to the grumbling day laborers. Rather than feeling fortunate to have found work for the day, they feel unfortunate at having not received more. Rather than rejoicing that the other workers have waited all day for the prospect of work and return home blessed to be able to feed their families, they can only begrudge them, perhaps even curse them, for their good fortune. And rather than be grateful to the landowner who has given them an honest day's wage for an honest day's work, they can only grumble with resentment. Resentment. It starts with what you can see, and it can also come about because you're not seeing the context that you're in. There's a historical dimension to this parable. Jesus tells it to illustrate and point to the hardness of heart with which those who deem themselves righteous, considered those who almost by any standards are not, begrudging them the grace and mercy of God and the attention of God's Son. But it also speaks to our own day, and our own time, and our own lives, as it ever did to Jesus' original few. Because this parable lays in front of us, and each of us, a choice. When we look at our lives, do we count our blessings, or do we count our misfortunes? Do we pay attention to the areas of plenty in our lives? Or do we put our attention on what we perceive we lack? Do we live by gratitude or by envy? Envy is because I am generous. Do we look to others in solidarity and compassion, or only see them as competition? See, the killer thing about this choice is it's really a choice that's unavoidable, and it's very straightforward. You can't be grateful and envious at the same time. So, which is it going to be? See, Jesus had another vision, another way of looking at and being in the world, and he called it the kingdom of God. And so, I invite us all to consider some resentment or grudge that we hold in our hearts. Something that we believe we lack, or something of which we are envious. But be honest, because honesty matters. And call to mind a blessing, some area of abundance, something for which you are grateful in your own life, or perhaps in the life of somebody else. And once you're done, place those things side by each in your minds. And then take out a pen and write the two things down on two separate pieces of paper. Then pick up the sheets in your hand. And you'll notice that physically the two pieces of paper weigh exactly the same. But spiritually, one of those pieces of paper is weighing you down, while the other one is light as a feather. Get rid of the heavier one of those pieces of paper. Because you can't keep both. You have to choose. Keep the other paper as a kind of reminder. And what matters is the choice you've made. And the reminder that you take with you into the rest of the week to focus on your blessing. Perspective matters. What do you see? Will we always be true to our choice? No. But this could help us be more true. And in the end, the only one who is true is the one who came preaching and teaching and embodying this new life and kingdom, the one who is willing to die so that we might see the grace and goodness of God and believe that that new life is even possible. But let's be clear, while this one's true, he's not fair. Because this one gives us a lot more than we deserve. loving us from the scourge of scarcity and fear, the new life of abundance, courage, and faith. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us bow in one more prayer. Beloved God, your blessings abound in our lives. And we lift up that inner voice inside us in gratitude for those lovely gifts from you day by day. We also lift our voices as we cry out for concerns. Concerns for others, or perhaps for ourselves. Concerns about those who are ill. Those who are going through a process of mourning and loss. For those who feel lost, we offer to you our joys and our concerns, often intermingled in the midst of our lives. Before you and in our minds in the quiet, we name these things before you, O God. Beloved, we pray for the world in which we find ourselves. For those who do not have enough to wear or enough to eat. For those who experience injustice day by day. We pray for our government confronting problems that it did not ask to confront. Problems that are in our lives, concerns about illness. Concerns about relations with other countries that have become very complicated. We pray for those who work in hospitals, dealing with the issues of illness day by day. Continue to bless those who work there with strength and with courage. How they go in and work each day with the threat of illness looming over them with COVID. Continue to be with them. It must be very hard for them. Continue to be with those who deal with other complications from day to day. And with the challenges they greet because their lives are not what they expected them to be. Concerns over their work. Concerns over their families. Bless them with a sense of peace. Also bless them with a good community to help them as they go. Be with us all as we go into this week with our concerns. Help us to see as you are answering those needs that present, that we feel deeply inside us. Help us to embrace the gifts that you are giving to us today and tomorrow and throughout the rest of the days of the week. We ask this in the name of Christ. Allow your hearts and minds to receive the gifts of our closing hymn, "For God We Know Thy Great Jehovah."
Thank you.
you are able, please rise for words of blessing. Go forth into God's world as God's own children. Let the love of Christ be reflected in your life and in your deeds. Go with joy to serve Christ. Go with the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.